Now, for those watching on the internet, we're not normally as unprepared as this. It normally goes a lot better, but the furniture has been moved around during the week, so that's part of the reason. So thank you, Phil, wherever you've gone. As I was saying, it's good to see you all this morning, and a very warm welcome to everyone, including those who will join us later by the internet. It's a very special pleasure also to welcome back my first assistant here in McQuiston, the Reverend Angus Stewart, and Rosemary, his wife. So, Angus, it's a great pleasure to have you both back this morning, and we're looking forward very much to what you have to say. And we've certainly at home, we've been praying that God will anoint you with His Holy Spirit as you speak this morning. So the announcements, the bulletin has stopped for the summer, as we said last week. So most things have come to an end. A few things this week just to bear in mind. For the elders, we are meeting on Thursday evening at 7:30. And part of that will be meeting the convener of the vacancy, the Reverend Richard McElhattan. So it's really important for the elders to get along to that meeting if you possibly can. Thursday night, 7:30. Also, for those leading worship, we have an evening with Dave Whitcroft, who was here a few weeks ago, led us in worship and also sang a few of the songs that he had composed. Just discussing together how we can improve and reach for excellence in our leading of worship here in the church. So that's on Wednesday evening at 8:30. For those who lead worship, and they know who they are. Can I just maybe direct you, since the bulletin has finished, just to give you a heads up as to what is happening through the rest of the month. Tonight we have part three of the Grow course for those who had enlisted or enrolled for that, and that will be hopefully in the DD Boyle. If there are technical issues in operating the video, it may be in another room, but if you go there initially, we'll take it from there. Then on the 19th, which is next Sunday, we return for the concluding part of Ephesians, chapter 6, verses 21 to 24, Paul's farewell. And again then in the evening, Dr. Paul Bailey will be back for his final part on 2 Chronicles, the final in the series. So for those two services next week, I do encourage you to come along, 11 in the morning and then 7 p.m. at night. Then Sunday the 26th, which is my last Sunday with you, preaching, certainly in this role, we're going back to where we started. Going right back to Sunday the 9th of September 2001, and we're going to look again at the two passages that I began with under the title Changing World on Changing Word. We've had 21 years of change. The world around us has changed in those 21 years, yet this is still true, that while the world changes, the word does not change. So I want to encourage you along to that service, 11 a.m., hopefully in the providence of God, we'll have some things to say to the congregation that hopefully will be an encouragement in the coming days. And certainly my intention is to encourage everyone to look to God and to His unchanging word. And then in the evening on the 26th of September, 26th of June, I'm going to look at a passage, John chapter 1, 19 to 30. We know the program The Voice on television, and that will be the title. We'll be looking just at John the Baptist's ministry and how that concluded as he pointed to Jesus. Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. So that's the evening of the 26th of June. Well, these are all the announcements. This, you may or may not know, is Trinity Sunday. Last week was Pentecost. Today is Trinity Sunday. And as we prepare for worship, let's have a moment's prayer, and then I'll lead in some words that point us to the Trinity. God, our Father, we pray that you may still our hearts, and that you, Heavenly Father, would come and meet us in this place. As we come together in your presence, we seek to worship you, to praise your name, and to give you all the glory. Three-personed God, you're a wonder. God the Father, our Creator. God the Son, our Deliverer. God the Holy Spirit, our Sanctifier. United and yet each unique. Sole God, but not solitary. Three and yet one. Thank you for this mystery, that at the heart of the universe there is a communion of love. And these things we pray in the name of Jesus the Son. Amen. Well, we're going to worship God as we stand to sing our opening song, Be Still, for the Presence of the Lord, the Holy One, is here.
Well, good morning, everyone. It is so good to be back here at McQuiston with you. As I look around, I see so many faces. I remember, see a few new faces as well. But it is lovely to be back with you. Rosemary and I have been looking forward to this. So I want to say thank you to Mr. Beggs for his invitation and the privilege of taking part in the service. We're going to continue to worship God, this incredible truth that the God of the universe who made us is here present with us. So we're going to continue to worship him as we pray together. Let's pray. Almighty and eternal God, King of the universe, we worship you, O Lord, for you are great and you are full of splendor and majesty. And today, our great triune God, we praise you as the one who is from everlasting to everlasting. And today, our Father God, we thank you that you are always there, whatever the circumstances, good or bad, You are always there in our lives. And what comfort to know that we can always turn to you, always talk to you in prayer. And this morning, our God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we praise you for who you are, love itself. We marvel at the greatness of your love which reaches higher than the highest heavens, deeper than the deepest pit. And we thank you for showing to us your love, that concrete reality, even in the constantly changing and challenging world around us, your love from which through Jesus we can never be separated. And so we praise you today, our loving Heavenly Father, and we thank you for the security that is ours in Jesus and for the help which is ours by your Spirit. And Lord, as we take the name of Jesus on our lips, it is with amazement and awe that we remember how your love for us, for this world, is so great that your Son came to earth. He came to earth and lived our life and died our death. And 2,000 years later, the shadow of his cross still falls over us. The shadow of his outstretched arms still covers us in this meeting house. What amazing love. What a price you paid for our salvation. So, Father, this morning as we think on this, we have to say we are humbled by your mercy. We are broken by your love. Never let us take it for granted. We have to remember and confess it was our sin for which Jesus died. So, Holy God, this morning as we confess our sin, we cringe. When we remember those things we've done in the dark, we blush when we think of what goes on in the secret places of our hearts and minds. We cannot hide it from you, Lord, and yet we don't want to hide it from you, for only you can deal with it. So, Lord, this morning, will you put your finger of love upon all that is wrong within us and cause us to confess it, and to ask for and to receive your forgiveness and your cleansing. We plead Christ's body broken for us, his blood shed for us. Lord, may forgiveness and cleansing be the experience of each of us, even here, even now, as you move among us by your Spirit. So, Holy Spirit, please continue to come, continue to move. Help us all to know that the Lord is our God. And let us give glory to him, for he and he alone is God, and he is here. Amen. And folk, as we have confessed our sin in our prayers, as we've asked for forgiveness, there's that beautiful verse from 1 John chapter 1, verse 9. He is faithful and just, and if we confess our sins, he will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. So, as forgiven people in the presence of God, what are we going to do? Well, we're going to ask the children to give us a hand this morning. Can you stick your hands up if you're children, boys, girls? Stick your hand. Let me see where you are. Brilliant. So we have a few children with us. So I'm afraid that means, congregation, I'm going to need your help as well. And I see Paula Graham is really looking forward to that. So, hands up if you have heard of King David. Yeah, everyone's heard of King David. And, oh, sorry, King David sometimes made a bit of a mess of things, didn't he? He got himself in all sorts of trouble. And do you know what he did when that happened? He prayed. He prayed to God, even when David knew it was his fault and he was wrong, and he knew it was those times that he needed to say sorry to God and ask God to forgive him. Do you ever have times like that in your life? Because I do. And then David, sometimes it was other people maybe caused him a bit of trouble, and David prayed and he asked God to help him deal with those people and those circumstances. And I don't know if you're like me, sometimes I have times like that in my life. Can you relate to that? I'm going to read for you some verses from Psalm 86. And as I read this, boys and girls, I'd love you to listen. and try to hear all the different things that David is asking for in prayer. And then we'll ask Paula Graham to tell us everything. So this is what God says in his word to us. He tells us about the prayer life of David. Hear, O Lord, and answer me, for I am poor and needy. Guard my life, for I am devoted to you. You are my God. Save your servant who trusts in you. Have mercy on me, O Lord, for I call to you all day long. Bring joy to your servant, for to you, O Lord, I lift up my soul. You are forgiving and good, O Lord, abounding in love to all who call to you. Hear my prayer, O Lord. Listen to my cry for mercy. In the day of my trouble, I will call to you, for you will answer me. We finish our reading and we thank God for speaking to us about our prayer lives. Now, boys and girls, this is where I need your help. If you look at the screens with me, we will see a question. And would you read that aloud with me? Maybe the whole congregation would do that. Read this aloud with me. Who do we speak to when? So we're going to see some photographs, some pictures of different people. And we're going to have a wee think about who they are. You need to tell me who they are and when we might speak to those people. So our first slide, who or what is that? It is a police officer, isn't it? A female police officer. And, you know, if we're out and about and something happens, we might go and speak to the police officer who's going to help us and keep us safe. So our next slide, who do you reckon that might be? We're on a roll here. I said, oh, a doctor? And I heard that from up there as well. It's a doctor, and maybe, boys and girls, if you're not feeling well, your mum, your dad might take you to the doctor, you'll speak to the doctor, and they'll help us get better. Then our next slide. What do you think's happening there? Who's that? Any ideas? I'm deaf, you're going to have to shout. It's a shop assistant or a store assistant. And maybe you've seen your mum out shopping and she asks the store assistant for some advice to help her get what she needs. And our next slide, who is that? Teacher, isn't it? And if there's something we don't understand in school, we can ask the teacher, speak to the teacher, and they'll help us understand. And then the final one, what might be going on there? Parents. And you know, I was thinking, isn't it amazing that you can speak to your parents, your mum, your dad, your grandparents? You can speak to them every day, and you can speak to them about anything. And you can speak to them if you're happy, you can speak to them if you're sad, you can speak to them if you're in trouble, you can speak to them if you're really happy about something. And I was thinking about this, that all of these people and all of these times we can speak to them about different things. It's just like we can speak to God, isn't it? And so we have this next slide. Remember the question, who do we speak to when? Well, we speak to God when we're happy or sad, when we're good or bad. We speak to God any time and every time. And is that not just the most incredible thing, that the God who made this whole universe, who made you and me, listens to us when we pray to him through Jesus with the help of his Spirit? So would you read this with me, this slide, just as it's up there? Speak to God when happy or sad, good or bad, any time and every time. Folk, is that not the most amazing thing that we can do? So boys and girls, will you remember that? And more than remember it, will you do it? You can speak to God when you're happy or sad, good or bad, any time and every time. So we're going to pray together. I'll start off leading us in prayer, and then it would be great if we all join together in the words of that special prayer that the Lord Jesus taught us to pray. And the words for that will be up on the screen. Let's pray together. Father God, we want to thank you for our children, for the joy that they bring to us. And this morning we say, what wonderful encouragement to us to know that they are within your wonderful promises of covenant love and grace. And we thank you, Father God, for reminding us about prayer this morning. We thank you that, like us, our children too can pray to you at any time and every time. So will you always remind them of this, so that faith in Jesus becomes part of their everyday lives and prayer as natural as breathing. Will you help our parents and our children's workers to teach our children to pray? And Lord, will you grant to all of us that our children may see and hear in us as a congregation lives full of prayer? So help us now as we continue to pray using the words that Jesus taught us as we say aloud together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Well, we're going to stand and we're going to sing together this praise song that reminds us how we can speak to God in prayer. Did you ever talk to God above?
It's been our practice, just whenever assistants have come back, to ask them a little bit about what they've been doing and update us really about what has happened since they left us here in McQuiston. And I said to Angus, there's nothing going to be complicated. Angus, could you explain the Trinity to us? Angus, you left us 2002, was it, or 2003?
Three.
And you went to Dundrawn.
Mm-hmm.
How did things work there? How long were you there? And
yeah, so I arrived 2000, I think it was, as your student assistant, then associate minister. And after that, Robert, I took to the hills. up to Belfast Hills and just around Nuts Corner, where Dundrod is, a country congregation, obviously very different to this part of Belfast. But we loved Dundrod. We had a great time there, and we were only there for about 6 years, but God was so good, we began to see him doing some really incredible things towards the end of that. And then very, very suddenly, unexpected and not looked for, White Abbey came along.
That's always a challenge, Angus, sort of moving. I mean, I've done it once, and I wouldn't, to be honest, like to do it again, to move from one to another, though having said that, I mean, I'll be leaving this congregation eventually, but how did you cope with that, and how then did you set about, because the situation in White Abbey was much different, mm-hmm. big congregation, mm-hmm. thriving congregation. What were the challenges that when you came to it?
So I think it was difficult to leave McQuiston, difficult to leave Dundrod. So there's just all of that going on. Big change for Rosemary, obviously, for the girls at the time. So there's all that family stuff going on in the background. And then, as you say, Robert, moving not back to the city, but to a suburban congregation, very middle class, professional, much bigger staff team. So I think in some ways it was like going back to work and nearly becoming a manager again. And in other ways, well, ministry just doesn't change, but the way in which we do it often has to.
Hey, it's interesting you said about the staff team, Angus. I've finished all my staff team off.
You have no idea, folk. No idea.
See them out. There is a benefit, though, in that, having a team of people to work in a congregation, isn't there?
It's been an incredible blessing for me personally. And I think even the last 2 years, we've a great staff team at White Abbey, and they've just been exceptionally good in the last 2 years. And I think it's not just the paid members of staff, Kirk Session, that's been really sensible but yet sensitive to both the congregation and more importantly to the Lord and what he's been saying in a committee that's just been so solid. And so many people have been working really hard.
Well, I mean, for us all then, Angus, I mean, established ministries, we've all been challenged by the COVID pandemic, mm-hmm. and what that's brought on to the church, and even, you know, the difficulties in getting up and getting going again. What are the challenges, particularly at the moment, do you see for White Abbey, but for the church in general?
I think personally, I have a regret that I didn't buy shares in Amazon and Zoom right at the start. I'd be worth a fortune now. I don't know, Robert, I might have a... Sometimes I worry that we're all doom and gloom. Sometimes I worry that we think this has been the worst thing that has ever happened or could ever happen to the Church of Christ. And it seems to me that 2.5-3 years after this thing was invented or developed or whatever the word is, it seems to me the Church of Christ is still here. And we might be doing things differently, but folk, you're still here, you're still worshiping God together, you're still meeting together in small groups, you're still following Jesus every day, and it seems to me that Christ is still on the throne. And I think maybe one of the things we might need to maybe think a wee bit more about is what we have actually learned about Jesus and what we've learned about ourselves in the last 2 years, because I think I think a few things may have been exposed about our faith and our lives and what's really important to us, and I think we need to learn from that. And then I think as we look forward, we really have got to understand, at least I feel I've got to understand, it's not just about coming out of pandemic, but it's actually about going back into a world that hasn't changed. But that world is actually still incredibly hostile to the Church of Christ. We live in a society that's increasingly secularized and secularizing. We live in a society in which the church is being pushed into the corner. And so I'm wondering, how do I and the congregation nurture our children to equip them for that world? How do I equip parents to help them bring their children up? How do I work with teenagers and young adults, because they're living in this world? How do I help their parents and grandparents as we all try to follow Jesus every day? But at the same time, Jesus is still on the throne. He's brought us through this. And I was thinking, I don't know what you're like at McQuiston now, but the oldest member at White Abbey was actually born in the last year of the global pandemic at the end of World War I. This is not new. Christ has been faithful. He's brought us through. And so I think these are incredibly challenging days, but I think they're days full of great opportunity.
Yeah, it's interesting you say that, because at the prayer meeting on Wednesday night, we really ended with that. Jesus Christ, the same yesterday, today, and forever. And we never need to lose that thought and lose sight of Jesus in all of this. I think maybe the church is slimmer than it was.
I wish I could say the same for myself.
But well, don't we all?
Right. Yeah, right.
Don't point at me, my goodness.
Always three back.
Well, listen, Angus, are there a couple of things that we can pray for just for the future?
I think give thanks. I think the Lord has brought us all through what's been a challenging time, so give thanks for that. I think prayers about we at White Abbey anyway, we seem to be missing our younger families. They haven't come back the same as other age groups. So praying about that. Praying for wisdom for all of us about how do we follow Jesus faithfully in this very different and challenging world, and how do we help each other do that. And above all, just that we can keep our eyes fixed on Jesus and follow where he's leading us.
Good. Well, let's just do that now. Let's pray together. Our God and our Father, we want to thank you today for your faithfulness to us in every circumstance of life, in the good times when you bless us, when the sun is shining upon us and we feel happy and joyful, but also in the darker, sadder times, when despite us perhaps losing sight of you, you're still with us and still the same God of love, still the God of mercy and the God of grace. And we thank you for that, Lord. And we do pray just for Angus. We give you thanks for him, for his ministry here, for all that you achieve through him in this place. We thank you for the blessings that he received, he and Rosemary, from your hand in Dundrod, and now in White Abbey. And Father, I pray just that you would anoint Angus with your Holy Spirit, that, Lord, you would speak powerfully through him, both here today and in White Abbey as he continues his ministry there. And Lord, that you would bind Angus and Rosemary and the church family in White Abbey in closer fellowship day by day. Lord, we do want to thank you for your faithfulness through the challenge of the last few years. We do pray not only for White Abbey, but for our own congregation, that you would gather the people again, that your Holy Spirit, Lord, will speak to those who have lost interest perhaps or drifted in some way, that you would particularly draw the younger families back into worship, and that, Father, that you would constantly remind us that this is not something that we do. The battle is not ours alone, but the battle is yours. And that though we struggle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers, we do so with the power that comes from the Holy Spirit, in the knowledge that Jesus Christ has overcome all things, that he has overcome the world, and that his promises are firm forever. And these things we pray in Jesus' wonderful and powerful name. Amen.
We're going to turn to God's word again, just to a few verses from John's Gospel, John chapter 10. And folk, after we finish reading this, could I ask you to keep your Bible open? I'm sure you do anyway, but just a wee reminder. I'm going to read John 10, verses 22 to 31. So John 10, beginning at verse 22. Then came the feast of dedication at Jerusalem. It was winter, and Jesus was in the temple area, walking in Solomon's colonnade. The Jews gathered round him, saying, "How long will you keep us in suspense? If you are the Christ, tell us plainly." Jesus answered, "I did tell you, but you do not believe. The miracles I do in my Father's name speak for me, but you do not believe because you are not my sheep." And then these are the verses coming up I'd like to focus on this morning. Jesus still speaking, "My sheep listen to my voice. I know them, and they follow me. I give them eternal life, and they shall never perish. No one can snatch them out of my hand. My Father, who has given them to me, is greater than all. No one can snatch them out of my Father's hand. I and the Father are one." We finish our reading again. We thank God for speaking to us. I'm going to turn to prayer again, and we'll pray for others. Let's pray together. Loving Heavenly Father, our Shepherd King, help us to remember with great thankfulness all that you have given to us. Help us to count our blessings every day and to give you our thanks, because you are the one, our God, who is open-handed in his generosity to us. And Father God, sovereign God, we pray that today you would increase our faith. Let us remember that you are God, our Maker, that the Lord Jesus is enthroned on high, and to him you have given all sovereign power and authority. And you're the God who hears our prayers and answers our prayers. Increase our faith. As Robert and Karen approach retirement and a new phase of life, will you let them sense your pleasure with them for so many years of faithful ministry here in McQuiston, for even more years of faithfully following Jesus? And as our congregation approaches a vacancy, remind us of how gracious and faithful you have always been in the past. Reassure us, O Lord, that you do not change, and that you have plans to prosper and bless your people here. Will you impress upon us the truth, and let us rest in the security it offers, of how all the days ordained for each one of us were written before one of them came to be, and how secure we are in your will. And we pray that, O Lord, and we mean it, and yet we know that so many folk go through difficult times, and so we want to pray for those folk. Healing God, we pray for a special touch of your hand on those who are ill, who are lonely, who are struggling to come to terms with bereavement and grief, who are disillusioned or confused, whose faith is marked by doubts and dryness. We pray for all whose lives at home or school or work are full of joylessness and meaninglessness, whose relationships are foundering, who are nearing physical death. Lord, in your grace, meet them in their need. We want to pray too for our world, for we remember our province as issues around Brexit and protocol make the headlines and deadlines come closer. We pray for our national government in seeming disarray still. We pray for our Queen, and we thank you for last weekend of celebration. But Lord, we are mindful that not far from here, Ukraine is still in the throes of resisting a Russian aggressor, much death and destruction daily. Help us not forget that war is raging only a couple of days' drive from where we sit right now. Help us to remember the plight of Ukrainian refugees, the people of Afghanistan facing hardship, so many immigrants on the Channel Coast, the ripple effect on the whole world of food shortage and fuel cost increase. Lord, we pray for our world with so many challenges, asking, Father God, that you would have mercy upon us
and be gracious to us. And Lord, as we come to your word, help us to know that we continue to worship as we listen, as we hear the voice of Jesus speaking, and as we respond in faith. So by your Spirit, help us do that, we pray. In Christ's name, amen.
But we'll stand again and we'll sing our next praise, My Jesus, My Savior. So, nearly 20 years as your wee assistant and associate at McQuiston. Folk, I just want to say very briefly, both Rosemary and I loved our time here with you. We actually still tell some of the stories, not all, just the respectable ones, but we loved our time here. We loved our time with Robert and with Karen. We give thanks for the friendship that began then, that has continued. I have to say, I hope I said it when I left, I want to say it again, this congregation was such an incredible training ground for a young minister. You folk were so patient, so kind, and it was such a formative influence on my life and ministry, and on Rosemary as well. Robert, as you can imagine, was a brilliant boss. Oh, no, come on, that's unkind. Oh, he was. I actually still quote some of the things Robert said to me, to my assistants. But it wasn't just what Robert said, but how he did things. And there were times I remember what Robert did and how he did them, and I tried to do them. It wasn't just Robert, it was Karen.
because as a couple they are incredible, and they've been such a blessing to us, and I know to you as well. But I have to say, folk, I had some strange experiences at Quiston, let me tell you. Now, I'm going to share one of them. Now, it has to be said, I am not at my best first thing in the morning, okay? So please bear that in mind as I tell my wee story. But you know how sometimes you are, maybe you're drifting off to sleep at night, or you're just trying to wake up in the morning, and you're in that half-dozy, half-awake, half-asleep state? Anyone relate to that? Get the hands up. Just a few folk prepared, to be honest. I'm a wee bit like that. Impossible to focus, impossible to think straight. And one morning, I woke up, it was dark. I was very much in that state of mind. I reached out my hand. I couldn't feel Rosemary in the bed anywhere. Sort of raised my head, had a look. She wasn't, couldn't see her in the bed anywhere. And my first thought was, wow, Rosemary's been kidnapped. And then, and this is true, and then the strangest thought came to me. Jesus has come back. There's been the rapture. I've been left behind. I wasn't a Christian after all. What on earth are the minister in Kirk Session at McQuiston going to say? Why they also might have been left behind is a different story. I won't go into that this morning. But folk, they were happy ending because obviously, well, the rapture hadn't happened. My theology was awful. And Rosemary had just got up to have breakfast. One of those silly wee stories, those wee experiences that we all have. But I wonder if it highlights a question that I think all Christians face in their lives. And it's on our next slide. Do you ever wonder, am I really saved? Do you ever wonder, does God really love me? Do you ever wonder, have I let Jesus down? Do you ever wonder, is any of this real or true? Do you ever wonder, how sure can I be? Do you ever wonder those things? Because our next slide takes us to this, that doubting our faith, going through periods of darkness, I think is common to every believer, at least at one point in their lives. And sometimes this happens at moments of great change in our lives. So I'm thinking, Robert and Karen and family, a time of big change for you. Retiring from McQuiston, entering a new phase of life. As a congregation, McQuiston embarking on a vacancy and a new chapter in your future. Might this be a time when we have those moments asking, what does the Lord really think of me? Is my faith worth anything? Does he love me? So I remember becoming your student assistant in September 2000. A few weeks later, the then minister, the late Reverend Roy Robinson, left. Certainly not what I was expecting, but Mr. Robinson was very gracious and said it was nothing to do with me arriving. But I just wasn't too sure what was going on. I had third year to complete at college. This is a big church. The minister leaves, and as John Shivers, the clerk of session, used to say to me, Angus, you're really no use to man or beast, but you are the closest thing we have to a minister. Thank goodness Mr. Maxwell was here to sort us out. But folks, do you ever feel like that? As health declines, as things go wrong, as big challenges come, what's God doing? Does he still care about me? Does he still love me? I believe that this passage today, and I hope you take this away with you and look at it again, I believe this passage says this to us, that not only does Jesus love us with a love that will never end, he will never let us go, and he wants us to know it. Is that not an incredible truth for us today? This short passage is packed full of theology. The doctrine of the perseverance of the saints, the biblical truth that Christian believers will continue in their faith. It is central in Reformed theology, Presbyterian belief, ties into predestination and election. Let's get the big words out there. But folk, this is not dry because this is so practical and relevant and actually life-changing. And I hope we'll see that. I hope it is a comfort to us all because it's going to remind us of how secure we are in the hands of the Lord Jesus. Folk, do you want to hear that today? Do you want to know that today in your life? Because Jesus never lets us go, and he wants us to know it. Now, our next slide takes us on. I don't know, your minister, Mr. Beggs, is a partially keen gardener. Did you know that? And I remember every week our staff meetings ended with a trip up the road to the garden centre. And Robert, bless you, for 3 years, 2 years, whatever it was, you did your best to get me interested in gardening. We had lunch, we walked about looking at the packets of seeds and the plants, and Robert was so passionate about it, and I was just passionate about vanilla slices. Now, one commentator, the late James Montgomery Boyce, an American pastor, looks at this passage and he says, well, Jesus isn't a gardener, he's a carpenter. Jesus made things with his hands. And you can imagine Jesus using wood, using nails, can't you? And Montgomery Boyce says this passage is actually a wee bit like DIY or carpentry. Now, I don't know much about those, but if I wanted to fasten two pieces of wood together, I'd stick them on top of each other, I'd get a nail, I'd get a hammer, and I would thump the nail in until the wee pointy bit was sticking out the far end. And then I want to make it more secure, I'd get the hammer again, and I would bend the pointy bit over until it was at right angles and stuck into the wood, clinching. The nail is what that's called. And then if I wanted to make that even more secure, in would go a second nail, and it would be clinched. Montgomery Boyce says this is exactly what the Lord Jesus Christ does today in this passage, so that this is a secure truth deep within us, so that we cannot forget it and that we can hold on to it. It will never leave us. Jesus wants us to know he never lets us go. How does he do that? He uses words. Our next slide. If you look at verse 28 with me, Jesus says, the first nail, I give them eternal life. I give them eternal life. And Jesus is definite about that. He doesn't say, you guys here, I will maybe give you eternal life. Not sure about you. Don't like the hairdos. Not sure about you. And you guys here, eternal life, Sunday through to Wednesday, but yeah, I'm not sure about Thursday onwards. No, he doesn't say that. He says, I give them eternal life. Full stop. Isn't he definite? Not up to us, in a sense. The gift of salvation is just that. It's a gift of God. And he gives that to us whether or not we feel it all the time, whether or not we are happy with life. He gives it to us even when we have gone through horrendously painful and difficult circumstances, heart-wrenching loss, whatever it is. Jesus gives us eternal life. That's the first nail. And then he clinches it. He says in the middle of verse 28, again, please have a wee look at it with me, they shall never die. See, eternal life doesn't stop at the grave. Physical death is a release into the fullness of life with all the promises that God makes to us in that. Think of the 23rd Psalm, being in the house of the Lord forever. Jesus wants us to know that we are secure in his hands. He never lets us go. So Jesus clinches that for us. We are in his hands. Can you get that visual image? Held in the hands of Jesus. And then our next slide takes us on. In case we're ever tempted to doubt that, Jesus, he hammers in that second nail of truth. At the end of verse 28, he says, no one can snatch them. No one can snatch them out of my hand. And that's so simply said, isn't it? Just a few words. But can I ask you to think about that? Think about those hands of Jesus that hold us. Those are the hands that created the universe, aren't they? Colossians. All things created by him. And for him, those are the powerful hands that created the whole universe, are the hands that hold us. And then our next slide takes us on a wee bit more. These are creative hands. These are the hands of a carpenter. while he was on earth, his work of making still goes on, because we are told right now, the Lord Jesus is at work on our behalf, making a place for us in heaven. John 14. Why? In order that one day he's going to come back and take us to be with him, that we may be where he is. Those hands that hold us are also actively at work. And folks, do you remember when Peter was invited to walk on the water by Jesus, and he starts off so well, and he takes his eyes off Jesus, and what happens? Starts to sink. And what does Jesus do? Oh, you silly idiot. No, immediately Jesus reaches out and takes hold of Peter and saves him and secures him and keeps us in folk. Please hear this. During the storms of our lives, even when those waves of difficulty are threatening to wash us away, the hand of Christ always, always reaches out to take hold, to keep us safe, to keep us secure. I remember, I think it's safe to tell this story. I remember a few of us at McQuiston doing some door-to-door evangelism work. I think it must have been up around Orby. I don't know if you remember this, Robert. We were knocking doors, giving out tracts, trying to have a chat with folk. But it was a Saturday morning. I think there was something else happening. We had to speed up. So we started going around the doors on our own. We stopped going two by two. We wanted to speed up a bit. And I knocked on one door, no answer. Knocked on the door again. And then suddenly there was this patter of feet rushing down the steps. And the door was flung open. And it was a young woman. And she had only on a bath towel, and she was dripping wet. And boy, she was drop dead gorgeous. But honesty compels me to say, the look of absolute disappointment and dismay on her face when she saw me standing there with my clerical collar on was something to behold. I wasn't who she was expecting or hoping for. And then, to make matters worse, Mr. Beggs wouldn't let me go back to do the follow-up visit. But folk, here's the thing. Doesn't Jesus always, always do the follow-up with us? Doesn't he? His hands are always around us. He never lets us go. How often do we read in the Gospels of the hands of Jesus reaching out to touch people, to bless people, whether they're wee babies or folk with leprosy or women who are sick or whatever it is. The hands of Jesus reaching out to individuals, to people just like you and me, to assure us of his love, of his care for you as an individual. He never, ever lets us go. And I wonder, Robert, Karen, with all that is going on at the minute, and for the other members of your family as well, will you let yourselves sense those hands of Jesus surrounding you and keeping you? And you know that because he's always done that. Let yourself sense it. Let yourself know it. And for folk at McQuiston, a vacancy coming up, but also a new chapter in your history. Jesus is still King and Head of the Church. Will you let yourself sense the hands of Christ around you as a congregation? Will you remember how he has always been faithful to you? 1892. All right, John, 1892. Always faithful, and he's still the same. Let yourselves know the hands of Jesus guarding you, guiding you through so much. So, folk, whether it is a pandemic or a vacancy or a retirement, this truth about perseverance, this truth about assurance of faith, it's not just about getting to heaven, it is about how we cope with life's challenges. It is about the loving care of our good shepherd for us. And those hands of Jesus, as we think on them finally, are hands that are scarred. Because those are the hands that were spread out on the cross for you and me. And God can do nothing more to demonstrate the depth of his love. So folk, in our daily living, with all the challenges that we face, with all the hurts, with all the pain, with all the doubts, look at Jesus and see the incredible love of God for you. He never lets us go. Graham Kendrick, that beautiful hymn, "Come, see his hands and feet, the scars that speak of sacrifice, hands that flung stars into space to cruel nails surrendered." Jesus never lets us go. And then our next slide, those are the hands of Jesus that hold us. And then Jesus nails this, he clinches it. He goes on to tell us his hands are around us. And if you look at the text, verse 29, "No one can snatch them out of my Father's hands." So the hands of Jesus around us, and then the hands of Almighty God. It's as if they come around the hands of Christ. So we are doubly secure. Folk, can you get that image in your, not just your head, but in your heart? Let me rephrase that. Imagine a young boy receiving a telling off from a very angry neighbor for something that he had done, and any resemblance to me is totally coincidental. Imagine the wee boy standing in the street. He's feeling really lonely on his own. He's feeling scared as this big man looks as if he's about to start belting him. And all of a sudden, the wee boy feels a hand coming onto his shoulder, and the wee boy's father moves between him and this big, aggressive neighbor. And in that second, that wee boy knows he is safe. His dad's there. You can sort of imagine him going, "Come on now, my dad's here." But folk, I trust that every single one of us this morning can say exactly that. "My dad's here." Can we? Do we? Our loving Heavenly Father, whose hands are always around us, the Lord Jesus Christ, whose hands are always around us. And isn't that truth? Exactly what Paul is trying to say to us in Romans 8, and you'll see these words on the screen. "I am convinced," said Paul, "that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord." Folk, as you hear those words, don't hear my voice reading them to you. Hear the voice of your good shepherd speaking into your life. And don't just let them get there. Let them get there. And let them be a reality to you every day. Jesus never, ever lets us go. And then as we begin to conclude, folk, I hope you can hear how, whilst we need to do our best to hang on to Jesus, it's actually much more about him hanging on to us. It's one of the most comforting truths of our faith, to know that we are secure in Jesus, no matter what tests, trials, temptations, persecutions, pressures, pain come our way, whatever suffering, sorrow, sickness, we are secure in Jesus. His hands are always around us. The hands of God are around his hands. He never lets us go. Now, there will be times where that doesn't feel like it. There will be times when we're full of doubts, times when our lives may be full of sin, times when death approaches, times, Robert Caron, when one phase of ministry comes to an end and a new phase of life begins, time, McQuiston, when one chapter of congregational life ends and another opens. But it is at those times that we go back to what the Lord Jesus has taken such great time and trouble to explain to us. His hands are around us. And the hands of our loving Heavenly Father are around his hands. Folk, as we finish today, will you hear the voice of your good shepherd saying this one more time? "My sheep, listen to my voice. I know them, and they follow me. I give them eternal life, and they shall never perish. No one can snatch them out of my hand. My Father, who has given them to me, is greater than all, no one can snatch them out of my Father's hand. Our next slide. Jesus never, ever lets us go. Let's pray together. Safe and secure in our Father's keeping, in Christ's grip. Oh, Father God, we pray this for each other today, for all whom we know, brothers and sisters in the Lord, who are doubting their salvation, your love for them, who are facing times of great change and challenge in their lives. May we all hear the voice of Jesus, our Good Shepherd, speaking these words of comfort and certainty to us, not that we may presume upon his grace, no, rather that in the warmth of your love for us and your understanding of all our doubts and frailty and temptations and failures, you would draw us deeper and deeper into the strong yet gentle grip you have upon us because of Jesus and through the Holy Spirit. We pray this for Robert and Karen and their whole family today and this month, with all the changes this will bring. And we pray this for each other, for our whole congregation here, with all that lies ahead. Today, O Lord, help us to know that through faith in Christ, we are yours, and he never lets us go. Give us faith and increase our faith to receive this and hold on to it, for we ask it in his name. Amen. Well, we're going to stand and sing our final praise, a beautiful praise. What gift of grace is Jesus, my Redeemer?
Thank you.
So just before the benediction, Robert, may I say thank you again for your invitation to come and share with you. It has been great to be back. And on behalf of Rosemary and myself, may I extend to you and to Karen and to all the family our best wishes and prayers for God's blessing in the future. And folk, if I may say to the congregation, please know that you will continue to be in our prayers as you come up to a change for you as well. But right now, can I encourage us to bow together in prayer? We're going to pray for God's blessing. But we're going to do more than just pray, because we're going to receive his blessing, because our God blesses his people. Let's pray. Go now back into the world, stepping into the future God has for you, held firmly in the hands of Christ, held securely in the hands of your loving Heavenly Father, filled by the Holy Spirit. And as you do so, may the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace today and tomorrow and always. Amen.